I am Lois Langer Thompson. I'm the library director for all 41 of Hennepin County Libraries. And so, like a parent, I can't have a favorite, but I might say I might possibly live closest to this library, so that might impact how I feel. But I'm not claiming a favorite yet. Thanks, everybody, for coming again. Those of you who are here for the first time or the fourth time, we really appreciate you taking the time to be here. And in front of you, you have an invitation to what is actually our fifth meeting. This is the meeting where we'll have our first discussion with you about what's going to happen in the library. This won't be the only discussion, but this will impact who we ask to apply to work on this project with us. So it's going to be a really fun meeting. We won't make final decisions, but as a friend of mine likes to say, where you start impacts where you'll end, but you live with it for the rest of your life. So we want to start really well, so I hope you'll all come back and invite friends to that as well. Just a reminder for those of you who haven't been here before, remember the restrooms are straight out the door, and I'm going to turn it over to Bill, right?
Yes.
Thank you, Bill.
All right, thanks again and welcome. My name is Bill Neuendorf. I'm with the City of Edina, with the city's Housing and Redevelopment Authority. So tonight is similar to some of our past meetings, but in the first couple meetings, we did a lot of listening and questioning. What do you guys like? What don't you like? Those types of things. Tonight, we actually have something to share, a report back from all the different meetings we've had. For those of you that were at our first workshop, we had three different concepts that we tested. Some were tall, some were lower, some were in the middle. So we've taken all that input, and that's ultimately what we're going to walk through tonight. But before we get into the rehash of where we've been and where we think we're the direction we want to head, I thought it would be beneficial to better understand who else is in the room. So I think we did this last time. I know there's folks here from Hennepin County. Could you stand or raise? Excellent. Thank you. City of Edina. Staffers. And then Richfield. Are there some Richfield staffers? I saw Karen. Awesome. And then our experts from HGA Architects and Planning. We've got a handful of, excellent, awesome. So there are note takers and our guiders, and Victor is going to be our awesome presenter when I pass it off to him. And then also just to better understand who's in the room, who else is in the room, who lives in Richfield? All right, great. And who lives in Edina? Who lives in Minneapolis? Who lives in Bloomington? Who did we miss? And a business person.
Oh, business person.
Right?
Here.
Yep, great, thanks. So we're getting around. So they tell us that, the library folks tell us that the main audience for this library is really those groups that are represented here. Edina, Richfield, Southwest Minneapolis, Bloomington, sometimes even parts of Eden Prairie. But for this whole redevelopment concept, we've really focused efforts on Richfield and Bloomington. Richfield and Edina, because that's where the property is and our immediate neighbor. So I'm going to walk real quickly through where we're going to go tonight. Okay, so similar to our last meeting, I'm going to present what we've heard so far. And then Victor is going to walk through some updated concept sketches. Then we'll do some large group question and answer. Happy to get the questions on the table. But then we want to put you guys to work, like we did last time. There's a lot of great folks here. We want to want you working with your table mates to put your ideas and thoughts together. And then we'd like one representative from each table to report out to the whole group so that we can share our ideas to help better inform the process. And the process is the same as it has been. We are wrapped up with our initial visioning input collection, and now we're really trying to shape the vision. And the sketches that you've seen last meeting and tonight, this is not what's going to be built, but we're trying to get some understanding of what's the vision, like what could be possible here. After we're done with this type of visioning, that's when we'll reach out to real estate developers and real estate professionals to see what's actually viable and feasible for the site. Ultimately, the property is owned by Hennepin County, so our Hennepin County Board of Commissioners will make an ultimate decision about whether to sell the property, who to sell it to, what could possibly happen here, and then that developer will start a fairly lengthy process of zoning and architectural design and structural design and traffic studies and all those types of things. So we're still really in the very beginning of this process, By the time things get built and finished here, it'll be 3 to 5 years. So thank you for your vision, because sometimes some of these meetings, some folks expect to see an immediate result, and we're really trying to get ahead of the curve on this one. So part of what informs us, and this might look familiar if you were at the first couple meetings, but any project in the city of Edina is subject to the city of Edina code, our comprehensive plan, and over the last 2 years, the city has developed a set of guiding principles for urban design. Principles so that we'd get not just the bare minimum, but better projects. And with some of these ambitions, our goal is to take advantage of some of the great things that we already have here, to create an area, especially in the greater Southdale district, between the Crosstown and 494, that isn't just a bunch of suburban strip malls. I mean, this area has always been more than that, and it should always be more than that. But we really want to transform it to a place that's more walkable and friendly. Bearing in mind that whatever the scale of the building, the scale should be designed for people, not just for cars and buses and high rises, but for people, so human scaled. We've heard a lot of comments about architectural styles, and you can always argue whether you like that style or hate that style, but one of the important things that we've heard is that there needs to be a variety, and in fact a greater variety of architectural styles. The idea of mixed uses has been pretty popular, being more efficient in our design so that you can actually comfortably and conveniently walk from one place to the next. That's the mixed use concept. And while a lot of our population in this whole area is growing older, there's still a focus on being family friendly. Whatever shape, size, or age your family is, we want to make sure that we create a district that is encouraging to that. Green is important. This site is mostly asphalt and building. We want to make sure that there's more greenery added here. We've heard that quite a bit. And any project should be sustainable, looking out for future energy efficiencies and cost savings with that regard. Importantly, this whole area should be a city that you can enjoy in the summertime, and also recognizing that it's a city that you can enjoy and will have to enjoy in the wintertime as well. We want to be a place that appeals to multiple cultures and multiple generations. And finally, this whole Southdale area has always been a destination. I mean, to us, it's in our backyards if you live nearby. But since this whole place was built in the 50s, this has been a destination. We want that to continue, but to do so in a better way. So in our December listening sessions, all right, Victor, you put this on a timer and it's bugging me. This is how you get me to talk faster. In December, we had two listening sessions, and from those, there was basically a top 10 list. Things that people liked, things that people didn't like, concerns that were raised. I'm not going to read through all of them. But some of the key ones, we just heard time and time again, literally from every group that we met with, whether it was a big group or a small group. No, still yank me if I go on too long. We heard that people like this place, that the Southdale Library is important. Whatever your age, stage of life, or income, people find the library an essential element. And that's something that will definitely continue. We heard a lot about traffic. We heard a lot about safety. I don't feel safe crossing the street. Traffic is too busy. We've heard a lot of those concerns. We've heard concerns about housing. There was some acceptance of housing, but there was a lot of concern raised about more luxury housing that we can't afford. And there seemed to be a preference for housing of, if there is new housing, of more moderate means. If there's retail on the site, we heard that restaurant and small-scale retailers could be desirable. But something like a big box, like a Costco, another Target, those types of things weren't of interest. And we heard a lot about green space and open space. So those are some of the initial ideas. Last month, we presented three concepts, different sizes, different shapes, to kind of get some feedback and some direction. And this is the new information that we learned from there. While it wasn't unanimous, there seemed to be strong preference to have a standalone library building rather than a library mixed as part of something else. So the two concepts you'll see tonight are directly influenced by that. We have two standalone library concepts. We talked about parking and a lack of green space on the existing site, and there was a strong preference that new parking should be convenient and safe, but also hidden. There seemed to be a preference to see the good stuff rather than just a giant parking lot. When it comes to green space, there is definitely a strong preference to have more green space than less, more than is here today and is essentially as much as we can put on. And that green space should be flexible enough where you can have a farmer's market type event one day if that works, or you can sit out there and read a book on another day. So that kind of flexible type of programming. Regarding building height and scale, we heard that buildings along the Xerxes Avenue side that front Richfield should be generally smaller. Buildings that front York Avenue on the commercial side could be bigger within reason. I think we had one high-rise concept last month, and that was not strongly received by anybody. And there definitely was concern about putting too much on the site and being careful to avoid that, mostly for traffic reasons is the corollary of that. We also heard support for having mixed uses with a caveat that if they're done well. And then I think that jives really nicely with some of these principles in the Edina code about having more than just the bare minimum type of design. This next bullet point again talks about building massing, talking that the size and shape of the building should be generally smaller on the Xerxes residential side and larger on the York commercial side. We heard about traffic. And then this was a little bit of a surprise. Again, not unanimous, but last meeting there was strong support to have the library located on the Xerxes corner rather than the York corner. The jury's still split on that. So far the county is open to listening to both, but ultimately I think the goal is to decide on where the best place for the library is, because ultimately that's the reason that we're here. You know, it's about the library being rebuilt here, but in a way that makes the library more successful, not less successful. So tonight the two concepts, one will have the library on Xerxes and the other on York. We heard a lot about walkability and having sidewalks and bike routes and bike racks and bus stops and those types of things. And then last meeting, we heard another round of comments and preferences for some kind of cultural or community facility here. Whether it's a public type space, arts programming, other cultural or community type spaces, there was a strong preference for that. And we'd like to explore that deeper with you tonight. That's something that is possible, but we really need your suggestions on what that could be and what it could look like and who could operate it and those types of things. So those are the themes that we heard at our last meeting. And then in addition to the public meetings, we're also doing a lot of outreach to market professionals. So this slide summarizes our market study. And a couple things to point out here. Let's see, so here's our prop, here's the site. This area in blue or purple, whatever color that is, that's our market area. So whether you're a retailer, whether you're looking at office space or looking at apartment or condominium space, we potentially draw from people in this whole area. As far west as part of Eden Prairie, down to the river, basically up to 394 and to 35W. So it kind of puts it in perspective that from a real estate view, they're not just looking at a 6-block radius. They're looking for a couple miles in all directions. And when you pull the statistics on the people that live there, it's kind of interesting. I pulled two measures that summarize it. Well, they don't summarize it, but they're two interesting features. The one on the top is age group. And the dark purple color represents people that live in this immediate area, in this market area. And then the lighter shade of purple represents the whole Twin Cities metro, Minneapolis, St. Paul, all the seven county region. And it's interesting, age, younger people are on the bottom, older people are on the top. You can tell that generally we are an older community. I don't think that's a surprise. Most people know that. But it's interesting, if you look at the proportion of older folks in this area versus the whole metro, on average, we're actually younger than the whole metro area. So you can feel good about that when you go home tonight. And then one thing that really, I think we have to, it helps me think about the future. This is a place that we stand out. On average, when you look at the whole metro area, our young people, age 20 to 24, are declining in the whole average metro area. In our market area, they're increasing. So these are the folks that in a couple years are going to get married and have kids. So as I've been thinking about this site and what might possibly happen here, you know, I'm looking at the older folks who use it today, but then I'm looking at the younger folks and their kids who aren't even born yet that are going to use it in 5 and 10 and 20 years. So I thought that was a really interesting anomaly regarding age. And then this, I guess these are both feel-good slides, but we also looked at the average income. And average income is always so misleading, right? Because it doesn't mean my income or your income, but it's the average. Whatever age group you are in, if you live in this market area, you're the blue color. The Twin Cities Metro is the green color. Whatever age category you're in, if you live in this area, you have greater wealth than the average Twin City resident. So that really influences, you know, sometimes people have asked, why are there so many expensive apartments? Why all the luxury apartments? Well, in this market area, on average, people can afford it better than they can in other parts of the metro. So that's some of the data that went into a very, very simple summary over here. We asked the experts over at Maxfield Research to look into a variety of different types of uses that might be possible or interesting here. Housing, retail, office, hotel. And essentially, this is their very high-level summary. So the strongest, the types of buildings that would have the strongest chances for success are condominiums, housing for seniors, and retail. Strong potential here. Office space and hotel has potential, but it's limited. You've got to make sure that you've got the right hotel, and you can't just build speculative office space. You have to have an end user in mind. So there's good potential, but it's limited. And then this is an interesting one for just regular rental housing. I was expecting they would say strong. They said modest. And basically their point was, it's a great market for housing, but there was concern that there's so much new housing that's been opened up in the last year or two, and more on the way in the next couple years. There is concern that they'd have to really study the economics of a new market rate apartment to know that it would be successful. So I think there's still potential, good potential actually, but they did temper it, and that was a surprise to me, quite honestly. So as we've talked about what might happen here and what it might look like and how could it help the library, this also has informed us, hasn't given us the solution. That's another reason that we're here tonight. But I wanted to share this high-level information with you guys because I think it does help shape the conversation. And I think this is, oh, look at that. Okay, this is so sensitive. I didn't even press the button. Maybe it's like heat sensitive, but... So that's where we've been. So as we've collected data, had meetings with you guys and other smaller groups and staff and a bunch of different folks, that's what we've collected. I'm going to turn it over to Victor Pechaty with HGA, and he's going to present where we are today and get to the high-level ideas that we have, because frankly, this is the first meeting that we're coming to share ideas to start moving forward. So I'm going to have Victor do that. He's an expert at it, and...
I might ask my friend Kelly back there to maybe turn off the front parts of the lights here. At the risk of us getting sleepy, you'll be able to see the slides much better. So then we'll turn them back on for Q&A. Can you all see this better now? Okay, great. Bill shared with you a summary of a lot of the input that we've received from the first two public open houses where there wasn't any work shown, just asking questions about the vision for the site. Then at our last time together, we showed, as Bill mentioned, three preliminary concepts of how the site could be laid out. Now, we're not designing the site at this time, but what we're really trying to do is develop a framework that emerges from this participatory process and becomes part of the request for qualifications for developers to show a framework of the voice of the community and what's come forward. Because there's been a lot of input, we've tried to distill it down to these four primary points. It's not all inclusive, but these four points seem to capture a lot of the comments that have been shared. First of all, it is a given that the redevelopment of this site will include a new Hennepin County Southdale Regional Library. So that's a given on the site. A major point of input has talked about outdoor space. A lot of comments about green space, as well as opportunities for outdoor programming that would be community and public oriented, which is a distinction from just being set aside for private use. We've had lots of conversations about mixed use developments. We showed concepts at varying heights and densities. So there have been a lot of input there that hopefully you will see some responses to tonight in a mixed use scenario that's beginning to represent the input we've been receiving. Lastly, we created a category called connection to surrounding neighborhoods. There are amenities and traffic areas for pedestrians and bicycles that are well developed in the area, but they're not all yet networked together. And this site provides a really significant opportunity to make a new connection among some of those neighborhood amenities. Just a couple of quick points about some of those items. The Hennepin County Libraries will be conducting a similar process to this that's library specific. So in this forum, we focused a lot on the site in general. There will be a public participation process that gets into a lot of detail on the library, but this is what we know so far. It will be approximately 70,000 square feet, which this building is a lot bigger than that. However, this building has had the Public Service Center, which has been relocated to Southdale. It has had courts facilities. So as you move those programs out, the amenities for public use of a library are staying the same or a possible increase off of this building. When we talked about shared outdoor space, we've heard a lot about the connection, and these images show some of that. Outdoor space that can be programmed. Some of it is leisure, just general lounging, people having their lunch, as well as program space that could serve performance and other outdoor programming. The mixed use elements, there has been a lot of comments about that, about not being too dense or too tall, or concerns about parking serving those. But you will see options that have mixed use at what we think is at a medium to lower density, medium to lower heights that really find that sweet spot of mixed use for this site. Finally, on this image, we've tried to label some of the amenities that can be connected, and some of them are, by pedestrian bicycle uses on the site. Centennial Lakes is in this part of the site. Trail heading westward past the YMCA to Adams Hill Park. This axis, as you know, connects up to the Galleria, and there is a passage all the way to Southdale Center. The site that we're on here is shown there in the orange. So in our analysis, there's a really wonderful opportunity to connect from green space at Adams Hill Park up to the Southdale Library site, through the site, to these intersections here, which then go on to the greater system of trails. So that's something to be looking for in these options. One quick analytical drawing, because it'll play into some of the options that you'll be seeing. Many of you know by driving here tonight that the site is in somewhat of a, it's been called a moat. So, you know, these are engineering elevations, but the big picture here is the site drops about 14 feet from Xerxes down to the low point of the site, then ramps back up again to meet York over on this side. That lower depression really provides some opportunities, particularly to conceal or build atop parking areas that could serve the development without large surface parking. So I'm going to summarize two options that we're bringing to you this evening. They're condensed from the options that some of you saw last time. I see some familiar faces, so I know some of you participated in the last workshop. The two options are similar. Both of them feature a freestanding new Southdale library now. We got input that was preferred over a library that was fully connected or became a base for mixed-use housing above. So both options will show a freestanding library. You'll see an option that shows the library at the intersection of 70th and York. That'll be the first option. The second option will show a freestanding library at the intersection of 70th and Xerxes. The parking configuration is somewhat different in the two options, which then affects some of the mixed uses. So this is a helicopter view of option one, and we'll sort of fly around it a little bit as we go through the presentation here. In both options, the white structure represents or is a placeholder for a new library. It's shown as a two-story building in both options at about that 70,000 square foot total. While we're certainly not designing a library just yet, it does show some concepts that talk about how a library could be linked into a development like this. We sensed a lot of love for the building that we're in right now. So there's some sort of nod or allusions to the building that we're in. You see some courtyards there. Again, whether the library has something like that or not, we don't know. But the concept is there's a connection between indoor and outdoor environments and a connection between a new library and the overall development of the site. So some notion of indoor and outdoor space. In the center, you see a taller mass, which basically is suggesting that there may be a neighborhood wayfinding device that could let light into the center of a library and could also function as a beacon after hours. So they're just some preliminary concepts of how a library could fit into this site. Both concepts will show a promenade connecting a green space that you see here on the right side of the slide that goes to the center and aligns with 70.5 Street, takes somebody through the site along a promenade, and then one can go either south or north to 70th Street. The site is porous, so somebody could circulate through the site in a number of different ways, but there is a formal promenade that makes that connection from York and 70th along the pathway there, labeled number 5, all the way down to Adams Hill Park. You see a preliminary idea here of a combination of hardscape and softscape. There is a concept for a hardscaped, say a paver-type plaza in the center of the site, anchored by the corner of the library. Off of that center plaza, you can see some spiraling pedestrian paths that sort of pinwheel off of that center plaza, sponsoring other green spaces, trees, other places to be on the site. This is as if you took a cut through this particular option, showing that this option essentially builds a lid of sorts over the depression on this site and utilizes that area as a base for parking that could then serve the various programs above. This is a slide as if you're hovering in a helicopter just north of 70th Street, looking south. One thing I want to point out here is this element here and also off of York are showing access points for vehicles to then descend down and get to the below grade parking area under the lid. We're just beginning to think about more detailed function on the site. Libraries need service areas. That's why we can drop off a book in one library and it makes it to another. It needs a place for those things to come and go. Does book drop happen on the surface? Does book drop loop underneath? Those are unknowns, but these concepts are beginning to consider those types of functions. The red and blue structures are generically labeled mixed use. It could be some retail dining amenities. Those would likely be at a street level. It could be housing that is located above. In both options, none of the mixed use structures are shown taller than six stories. Six stories is the tallest. Please, okay. six stories is the tallest structure shown. You'll see in this view that these elements are shown at two stories. And this zone here are shown at two stories. The concept shows the lowest structures along the Xerxes corridor. Two stories stepping up to three. This would be three, that would be three. And then as one progresses through the site going towards York, they step up to five and six. We just have a couple of low-flying views. These don't show the whole concept, but they begin to provide a way to sort of inhabit what that might feel like. So this is what you saw as the central courtyard element. Symbolically, the library structure is the only one that gets to overlap and touch that center court to show the sort of that is the anchor and the really keystone of the overall site development. This gives a better sense of the scale of some of the green space and amenities on the site. This image happens to be looking along the what we're calling the promenade. This is just about, you've entered the site just off of York, and it's looking eastward towards Xerxes. I mentioned the concepts are similar. Let's talk first about how cars are handled differently in this concept. In this concept, it's assumed that there is still underground parking under the library portion, which is now located at the corner of 70th and Xerxes, but the York half of the site, as well as the southeast quadrant, are built off of existing grade. They're built off the lower grade. So without the parking being underneath, to handle the parking capacity of the site, it would suggest a parking structure. Number 10 shows what would be a five-story parking structure, two of it underground, three of it above ground, entirely surrounded by mixed-use programming, concealing that parking structure. So what was underground here is shown in the southeast quadrant, surrounded by the mixed use. Because the western part of the site is working with the gray, the low area that is currently here, you'll see in these views, this concept attempts to take advantage of that by expressing those different levels. Just a preliminary idea, but it could lead to something like an outdoor amphitheater, a sloping space for performance. It could lead to some sunken green areas or gardens. So some of those low areas are made available by building off of current grade. It's best expressed in this section cut here. You can see that the library may open onto a folding green space like that that could be a leisure space and also used for programming. This is once again looking from 70th Street, looking south towards the site, and you can see the lower terraces marching as you go south. The promenade still traverses the site east to west at that higher level, connecting Xerxes to York. Looking at it from the Xerxes side, this is probably the most profound difference, showing the library sited at the corner of 70th and Xerxes. And we've talked with you before about the pros and cons of that. This situates the library on the so-called quiet part of the site, which might be a good thing for library programming. It does compromise its visibility from York. It ends up being somewhat behind other buildings. When it is on York, it really has a presence as an anchor of the site, visible to all. It is on a busier street. So those are just the kind of things to think about where the library would be sited. Again, here in the foreground, these red elements are shown as two stories. The blue are shown as three stories. So the lower elements, the library, of course, is two stories. So the lower elements are shown along the Xerxes part of the site. And you can see the 5- and 6-story structures along York. Just a couple more eye-level views of the amphitheater and the promenade.
Of the library?
Yes. Let's talk about heights in various mixed-use buildings. Because a library is what we call an institutional structure, that wants to have somewhat taller spaces. It has more sophisticated mechanical electrical systems. The library floor-to-floor height is going to be somewhere in the 16, 17, 18-foot range. What Bill is pointing out is that a two-story library might be 32 to 36 feet tall, which is about 3 stories of, say, residential mixed-use family housing, which has about a 10-foot floor-to-floor. So think 2 stories of library is about 3 stories of housing. I think that's the metric or that's the equation. Thanks, Bill. So that's an overview of the concepts that we're showing for this evening. Kelly, I ask you to turn the light back on? Thank you. What we're going to do now is take about 15 minutes for sort of big group questions and answers to see if you have any questions. Then we're going to ask each table to take a look at some large printouts of these options we have, discuss as a group based on some of these questions, share your comments, what you like, what you don't like, the critique. Each table is going to be given this list of questions. You can certainly comment on other things, but just to frame some of the discussion, we'll hand out some questions. We'll hand out some large drawings of the concepts, give about 30 minutes for tables to convene, discuss, debate, tell what you like and don't like. Please plan for each table to nominate or force someone to be an ambassador for the table. You will be asked as an ambassador to share or summarize at the end some of the high points of the discussion of the table. And then we'll summarize at the end. So that's where we're headed this evening. I think Lois and Bill and I are happy to take any big group questions for a few minutes, and then we'd like to break up into small groups. Any questions? Yes. Yes, to repeat the question was if we could more clearly describe in option 2 how to access the parking and how it works. So one access point is here off of 70th. In this case, it would slant downwards to underneath the library, where there would be some underground parking, and then one could continue to the south, and you can see it kind of aligns with the parking structure. So this same access point could take someone to the parking structure, and there's a second access here off of York. You can see this part of the site stays high, so a vehicle could come in off of York and also enter the parking structure. That's a good question.
Just to follow up on that, I think the some of the earlier conversation, we talked about access off of Xerxes as well. There's definitely some pros and cons about accessing Xerxes. But at the last meeting, access to Xerxes by cars was not well received. So we kept the focus on 70th and York for the car traffic.
It's a great point, and it has come up since we've, I think, had our first visioning workshop. And so that's a known issue that's being carried forward. York is a county road, right? Okay. And so both the city of Edina and the county would collaborate on what the solutions may be. Our current study is sort of within the site boundary of the current Southdale Library site, but because that question has been raised multiple times, it's being carried forward to the city and to the county as a concern that's come out of this group.
So we included that in one of those four key elements for success for this whole site, are those neighborhood connections, whether that's a bike path, a sidewalk, a crosswalk, a safe refuge in the middle of the street, a longer button, whatever the solution will be. We've heard that at every single meeting, so that will be part of the conversation moving forward.
Yeah, it's a great question. The answer is it has not been considered at that level of detail at this time. The honest answer is we're thinking of pedestrians, bicycles, as the favored traffic throughout the site, haven't yet talked about how to best separate them.
But that's one of the reasons we're here tonight. So those kinds of concerns, please jot them down on your tables. You've got post-it notes and oodles of pens. So that separation of bike and pedestrian traffic, that's important. We hear that a lot. So please jot that down to make sure that we carry it forward.
The specific elevations aren't known just yet. What this is showing is that the first level of the library would not be higher than what is currently the intersection of Xerxes and 70th, which happens to be the very high point of the 7 3/4 acre site. The finished elevation has not been established at this time. The library is not yet being designed. No, I'm only saying that's what's being shown here, that there will be on-grade access into the library at that location. That may or may not be the final configuration, but that's what's being shown in this concept.
So just to add to that, I heard a lot of conversation about preferring a two-story building, and that's why we're showing this, that, and Victor did a nice job of explaining that two-story in a library is not two-story in a home. And so when people were preferring that, I wanted to be sure people understood. So your question is right. We don't know for sure where we'll start and exactly how high, but it.
I appreciate
the explanation because it does make a difference. Yeah, yeah, okay.
This red piece is modeled as 2, and this is modeled as 3, and this is modeled as 3. Now remember, these are our concepts that are meant to reflect the feedback that we've been getting. This isn't a final design, but what is showing here is 2, 3, 3. Yeah. In these particular models, we're showing a somewhat taller height at the first level, assuming that it may be residential, but it could be dining, it could be a smaller restaurant, it could be retail, and then 10-foot floor to floors above that, which would assume a housing use.
So the question was, what type of housing? Luxury, low income, et cetera. That's why we're here tonight. We don't have anything specific in mind. The size of a apartment building, the floor-to-floor height, it's kind of the same, whatever the rent is. But in the past, we've heard some preference for more modest rents. We're certainly open to that. I've started conversations with the HRA at the city of Edina to see is there interest in trying to get an affordable housing project. I mean, by these renderings, even when they're a smaller scale building, it's 8 acres. You can do a lot on this site. So is one of the buildings more modest rents, and then that doesn't create a lot of revenue, but maybe one of the buildings on York is a more wealthy building, and that creates the revenue. So there's lots of different combinations, but again, we're looking for your suggestions and your preferences, so don't be bashful with those pens.
You're talking about the question or the comment was, I think about the proximity of some of this development to the curb or to the street.
Yeah.
I don't recall exactly what that dimension is, but the comprehensive plan has significantly widened those. I know it's 50 feet on York and 30 the rest of the way around. So this dimension by the comprehensive plan would be a minimum of 30 feet. I don't know if that's the way it's modeled there or not, but I'm guessing it's probably at that 30-foot mark that was defined by the comprehensive plan.
Great question. So the question was condos and whether or not they're feasible to actually be built. I think it's too early to rule them out altogether, but that's why we're going to go talk to real estate developers and see what they think is really feasible here. I believe there's a pent-up demand for condominiums. There seems to be more developers that are starting to take that risk again, but they're slow. I mean, there's a lot of legal risk in condominiums in the state of Minnesota these days. So if there's a preference for condominiums, I would pass it on to the developers that might show interest. If there's preference for apartments, I would pass that on to developers. But it's way too early to know exactly what's going to happen here. Great question. So the question was condos and whether or not they're feasible to actually be built. I think it's too early to rule them out altogether, but that's why we're going to go talk to real estate developers and see what they think is really feasible here. I believe there's a pent-up demand for condominiums. There seems to be more developers that are starting to take that risk again, but they're slow. I mean, there's a lot of legal risk in condominiums in the state of Minnesota these days. So if there's a preference for condominiums, I would pass it on to the developers that might show interest. If there's preference for apartments, I would pass that on to developers. But it's way too early to know exactly what's going to happen here.
These are a little bit larger than that, but if you divide into quadrants, it's a small, fairly intimately scaled urban block. There's a development recently in Portland that has done this. So the quadrant design is based on some of those principles that have emerged from that group. It is not hardwired into the development of the site, but it's part of the framework of these concepts, and that's where it came from. Good question.
And let me follow up with that. So if one of the eventual proposals that gets put forth calls for that, I think there's certainly an opening for that. I mean, it's a good concept. I think with the grade and the slope and the underground, there could be some physical challenges to that, but it's a great idea. Let me just respond to that. So the comment was about affordable housing and how there hasn't been much produced in this area. There were several projects that you're exactly correct. They're all market rate with no affordable. I think everything that is on the books coming forward will have some affordable units. There's currently 39 affordable units that are under construction. So we're making slow progress in that regard. But that's why I think this could be a good site for that, because there seems to be interest in the community. There seems to be political will on the side of the city. And we'll see if those two can come together.
Okay, just so everybody heard the question was about the development that would be directly along Xerxes with a concern about traffic volume as well as parking. Is that a fair way to restate the question? Traffic studies have not been done because there's not a development plan put forward yet. You know, we're developing this framework together here. And so what we've shown based on comments we've gotten is all parking access to be off of 70th and York. That's been one way that this concept has responded to that concern. Traffic studies would have to be done as part of any development proposal here. Again, while there isn't a plan in place yet, one way that residential parking in areas like this is set aside, made sacred, if you will, for residents, are programs that have to do with neighborhood parking permits. I'm making that up, that hasn't been discussed, but that's a technique that is used in areas that offer these sort of mixed use amenities. So that's what this framework is showing at this juncture. Some of the studies that you're referring to would come along with a development plan for the site. Watching the clock here, we would like to break up into table groups so that everyone here has a voice at their table. I'm going to ask my colleagues to begin to pass out the sheet of questions. We'll leave those up here on the screen. We'll pass out drawings of the concepts you've seen. You can start with these questions, but take the discussion where you wish.